Good morning. Good to see you here this morning. Glad to know that you're online worshiping with us as we come into the sanctuary, to the house of the Lord God Almighty, to the house of prayer, to the place where He has promised to meet with us, to gather in, and to care for us. This morning, as we continue to worship, as we continue to be pursued by God, let's surrender to Him this morning, allow Him to work with wherever we're at, whatever's going on, allow Him just to speak to us. Father, we pray this morning that You'd be with us, that You'd be with our friends who gather online with us, that we would sense Your presence, that we would know Your love, we would sense Your care and compassion upon our lives. Father, we come from all over. Some celebrate recovery, some celebrate newness of life. Others celebrate how You have been with them and watched over them. Others come with sorrow and grief fresh on their hearts. Others come just befuddled by what all is going on in the world. And we ask today that You would just meet with us as individuals and would hear from us as a congregation. For we ask this, Jesus, in Your name. Amen.
The Godhead three in one, sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen.
Well, we're glad you're here, glad that you're watching online this morning. You know, even a quick reading, even a surface reading of God's Word reveals a difference between those who belong to God and those who belong to the world. You don't have to go very deep. You don't have to read very many chapters. You don't have to reread the stories of the patriarchs or of the apostles before you realize that there are two different, divergent paths that are described in the Bible. Jesus clearly distinguished between his kingdom and the world. Time and time again, he doesn't talk about other people, he just says the world. He even says that he came to die for the world. He points out that there are two divergent paths that exists in our world. Now, do you know what a divergent path is? I would use the illustration of a circle and a tangent, except I did not pay attention to Mrs. Tifton in geometry class when I was in high school. She went on and on and on, and I was somewhere else. So I can only talk about divergent path. We think that the world is headed like this and the kingdom of God is headed like this, that we're on the same path. And nothing could be further from the truth. We're on a divergent path. That at the moment you accepted Christ, invited him into your heart to forgive you and to fill your life with his Spirit, you broke from that path and you headed in a 90... Oh, here comes the geometry... a 90-degree angle, divergent. And you began to go in a totally different direction than that the world was going in. That there is this divergent path that exists. And if we're not careful, we will begin to shorten the angle that we are supposed to be diverging from. And it shallows up to where it's almost as if we're walking on the same parallel line with the world. In John 15, verses 18 through 19, this is what Jesus says. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I've chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. God is love. Jesus is love. Why is he using this word hate? If God loves everybody, if Jesus loves everybody, why does he use this word hate? Because he's speaking the truth in love. The world hates those that love God. They hate us. It's not going to be good for those who not only say they love God, but obey God. The world hates believers. Why, then, do we act like they love us? Why do we try to be cozy with them? Why are we trying to get along with them? Why are we trying to hold our tongue and not speak to them about the obvious difference that exists? It's not as if we are better than them. We're just divergent from them. We have discovered forgiveness and have accepted it and have been called to share the good news of that love and forgiveness that is available to anyone who will accept it. Why do we try to fit in when we're clearly not like the world? You know, the world believes that it will continually get better. That if we just keep working hard, noses to the grindstone, if we continue to discover and research, and if we just continue to try to be unified in all things, that our world will get better. That it will reach the betterness of betterness. That it will reach the goodness of goodness. How's that working? How's that working for us? It's not like we just started today, right? I mean, this has been going on for quite some time. People who declare that they know what we need to do, and we need to head this way, and this system over that system, these philosophical principles rather than those philosophical principles. Jesus tells us that the world is coming to an end. Okay, so you have, it's radically different philosophy. The world says, we're working on it. We've even got a vaccine now. Your worries are almost over. We can end world hunger. When did we say that? That was a couple years back, wasn't it? How are we doing? Suffering will be eliminated. Medical advances will take care of every problem that we have. Jesus says, the world's going to end. It's not going to reach some good of goodness state. And Jesus says, oh, they're ready for me. I'm going to go back. His dad's going to turn to him and say, hey, son, now's the time. And he's going to show up on the scene, and that's going to be it. We're going to be with him forever. And all those things that have been promised by the world will actually be delivered by our Heavenly Father. Why then is there this slow roll of accommodation? Why is there this slow move towards acclimation in the lives of believers? Why do we shallow up that angle and try to get as close to the world as we can? Why do we try to live in both camps at the same time? The real trouble comes as we try to live in obedience to God and appease the world. There is a trouble there that we cannot overcome. There is this warning that God is sending to us in these days. He is forevermore trying to get our attention and the attention of the world to tell them, listen, you're just not going to figure this out. The problems you have need the answers, God says, that I have. All these different paths to inner peace and entombment with the universe, they're not working because they can't work because they are based on false principles. How can we continue to show our allegiance to God's kingdom? What do we need to be doing these days of pandemic and chaos and social unrest? As the people who have the answer, what should we be doing? How should we be going about living? Well, I think there's several things. And I think, first of all, we should acknowledge the irreconcilable differences that exist between God and the world. It's like being at the... did anybody take my advice at Thanksgiving and talk about politics and religion? Did anybody do that? I mean, thank you, Vernon. So, most of us sat around and somebody said something off the wall and you went, oh, well, there's an idea. I think I'll try that someday. You just wanted to go along to get along. And as believers and as people of the kingdom of God, there is this fallacy that exists that we can be like them so that we can win them. But that slow roll of accommodation is not going to do that. We need to acknowledge that there is the kingdom of God, and then there is the world. That they're incompatible. That they're two totally different things. In John chapter 17, verses 15 through 19, Jesus is praying for the disciples, and he's praying for us, but he's praying for the disciples. So, you know, you tune in to when Jesus is talking to the Father, and you know, they have a really good relationship. So he's just talking to him. We call it prayer, but he's talking to his Father. And listen to what he says. He says, "My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified." Listen, what Jesus is saying is the kingdom of God is visibly different from the world. That by our actions, that what people can see, by our words, what people can hear, they should notice a difference and ask about the hope that is within us. The principles are different. The goals are totally different. We have different agendas. We have a destination that we're headed towards. And God is calling us to understand that we are different from the world, but as hard as you can, drag as many as you can with you. We've got to fight off this slow roll of just fitting in. You know, I just want to have a peaceful life. James 4:4-6. James is not known. This is James, the brother of Jesus. This is not stepbrother of Jesus. This is not how you win people and influence your friends. "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." Again, that kind of language, it's not disputable. You can't say, well, what he meant to say there was. He is telling us that there is a divergent path between headed towards God and walking with the world. We cannot combine the two and still please God. I think also, not only do we have to acknowledge the irreconcilable differences, but we have to continue to be a witness regardless. Just like God loves us regardless, we too must be a witness regardless. And the key here is, it doesn't matter. You say, well, I've got to wear a mask and I can't get as close to people. It doesn't matter. Well, you know, we have to stay socially distant. It doesn't matter. You know, we can't be around people. It doesn't matter. We still are his witnesses. We still must shine like that city on the hill. We still must be the salt of the earth. We must be attractive to people so that they will ask, why are you different? Oh, we struggle for that herd mentality that we just go along. That we just get along. Jesus said it like this: "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." Listen, people are looking for what we possess. They're looking for the hope that we have. Now, one of the greatest features of a smartphone and one of the worst features of a smartphone are the same thing. That in the middle of the night, when you get an alert, a notification, a text, or, you know, there's a sale at Walmart and it pops up on your phone, that little phone shines at what, 6 gazillion lumens? It lights up the entire house. It'll wake you from a sound sleep. It burns its image on your retina. You know what I'm talking about. I'm not saying that my wife's phone ever does that, but on occasion mine has done that. And all of a sudden, it's like instant daytime. Jesus says, you should be like an iPhone 8. You should be like that other phone, that Android phone 5. You should be like that. And if you have a flip phone, you should be like a flip phone that has been flipped open and is left open. That light that is inescapable. That's what God calls us to be. Inescapable. So that when people see us and hear us and they ask about the hope, we can point them to Jesus. So we need to continue to be a witness. And I'm not saying it's easier in these days, except it is. Because people are tired of the chaos. And they are pandemic fatigued. They're not getting answers from their leaders. They want to hear the good news. Well, I think something else that we should be doing is we should be dwelling on the Word as an encouragement. My day does start better. Most of you are expecting me to say coffee. My day starts better when I read His Word and when I pray. It's just better. It changes the entire tone of my day. I don't drink coffee for myself. I drink it for other people. Being a serious student of the Word is critical. Every opportunity that you have, whether it's on Wednesday night, we invite you to be there. We invite you all the time. It's a good place to be. Maybe you have an app that you're using. I know people that are using different apps and they listen to that. Excellent. There is no one way to achieve a serious study of God's Word. There are many ways. And you cannot grow unless the Word is being applied to your life. You say, well, how does God do that? You know, I don't know. That's not my area. I'm not in charge of that. I just know that when I read it, He speaks. And I've told you before that my New American Standard Bible is filled with arrows where I just took my black pen and said, oh, this God's talking to me here. But I had to stop doing it because all the verses had arrows on them. I just might as well just say, you know, it's this page and most of this page, and it's all this whole chapter. God will speak through His Word. He can do that. You know what He did? He created all the fjords in Norway. Have you ever seen the fjords in Norway? I've only seen pictures, but that's on my bucket list. And if He can do that, He certainly can speak through His written Word to you. Also, you cannot share what you have not read. And if you want to be a witness, you want to have a verse to give to someone, you need to read it. Because I tell you this, God will hide His Word in your heart. He will put it someplace, and when He needs you to say that verse, you're going to start and stop and say, well, I didn't know I knew that verse. I don't remember memorizing that verse. But God will call it up out of your time in Bible reading, and He will use it. And you're going to stand back and go, did anybody get that? That's pretty good. Because He's like that. We have to immerse ourselves in His Word. And whether you read books at a time, chapters at a time, verses at a time, God will speak to you. 1 John 2:15 to 17. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. And how are you going to know what God's will is if you're not reading it? Because His Word is filled with what He wants us to do and not do. Everything that He wants us to do and not do is not sent to keep us from having fun or enjoying life, but it is a protection. It is an invitation to a better way. It is something that will be more meaningful for us and eternally end in a greater reward. But then also, We should be engaging in prayer. Recently, a good friend of mine, his daughter has developed this disorder. And I don't have any idea what's going on, really. She's in the hospital, I think, even today. She's very close to Nancy and I. And I found myself waking up in the middle of the night and praying. That ever happened to you? Do you know why that happens? Because prayer is such a powerful thing. I remember being in a church situation, and it was really bad. I mean, it's one of those, you know, where people say, oh, it'll just give you character, and I'm like, you know, I got enough character. Can we move on to something else? And I had a pastor friend that was just across town. He said, Huey, what's going on in your life? I said, what do you mean? He said, well, every night the Lord is waking me up, and I'm praying for you. And as a pastor, as a young pastor, I thought, well, that's how you know you're in a bad spot, is when God's getting other people woke up so that they'll pray for you, not knowing what's going on in your life. Prayer is a powerful ally for us. It is a powerful force that is unstoppable and unbeatable regardless of how hard the enemy tries. He cannot defeat prayer. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 to 5. Paul writes this, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." Sorry, my prescriptions ran out there for a minute. I couldn't read the word. You know, your prescriptions run out. That's why you have to go back and get other. They are only good for so long. And then it's just like anything. They have a shelf life. Sorry. Paul writes to the people at Corinth who were struggling with a lot of trouble, and he says to them, listen, we don't wage war like the world wages war. We have a weapon that the world not only doesn't understand but cannot defend against. We can demolish strongholds, and we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. You see, we have a confidence to enter into the very presence of God. Let's just take a beat on that. We have the confidence through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection, to enter into the very presence of God. Remember in the Old Testament? They had the temple of meeting. They had the temple. And once a year, when all the proper sacrifices had been made, blood had been spilt and blood had been sprinkled and incense had been offered, and the priest appeared at the entrance to the Holy of Holies where they could only go in for one day, only if all the right stuff had been done. And do you know how the right stuff had been done? When he got in there, he didn't fall over dead. He wasn't struck down by the presence of God. Now, I'm not going to say this happened a lot, but it got to where they would sew bells into the hem of the robes that they wore. So jing-a-ling-a-linga, jing-a-ling-a-linga, they didn't hear anything. You didn't send somebody in there because now you got two dead people in there. So they would tie a rope around the ankle. So when they stopped hearing the jingle, 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 lingle, they'd pull them out. Because, you know, after a while you get smart, you know. After 1,700 people have died, you think, hey, guy in the back's got an idea. He says we ought to tie a rope around him. Where was he 1,700 people ago? Those numbers are just made up for, you know, the illustration. Yeah, I'll move on. So the very idea that they couldn't only go in there except once a day, I mean once a year on the Day of Atonement, and only then, when everything had been done, you know, not pretty close, had been done exactly right. Now, you're standing there with the ding-a-ling-a-lingles and, you know, the rope on your leg, and you're going to part the curtains and go in there with the sacrifice. You think they got 25 people in line going, oh, could it be me? Could it be me? They're drawing lots. It's your turn. The Bible says that through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, we have a confidence to draw near to God in our time of need, where we might find mercy, His favor, His love, His compassion, His grace, that we can stand in His presence. No rope, no jingle jingle, no sacrifice, that whenever we need to, regardless of who we are as His child, that we can stand in His presence and say, Father, could You help me? Are You aware of this? Could we work on this together? Would You mind if I listened while You just talked to me about what needs to go on in my life? Could You comfort me for a little bit? Could You remind me of Your love? Could You tell me that I am worthwhile, that I am of value to You? Could You tell me everything's going to be all right? We have this confidence. You know, we have to decide to go along with the world or to be a citizen of the kingdom. And it will become more and more difficult to straddle that fence. It's not getting easier. It's becoming more and more difficult to shadow that angle and still remain a believer. Listen, it's not going to suddenly, all of a sudden, just get better. And everybody who has walked this way say, oh, well, let's just line up with the world. They're headed towards a glorious, glorious life. Appeasement is deadly. Acclimation is deadly. Apathy is deadly. At some point in my life, I got a 69 mostly blue Volkswagen. Now, it's mostly blue because Jeff said yada, 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 and I got a yellow door. Something else happened, and I had a different colored hood, okay? The yada, yada stuff from my brother, I was like, could you go through it again? Could you explain to me how that happened? So he sent me down to Birmingham to buy another door. Do you know how you get a door home from the Volkswagen place in a Volkswagen? You know, those doors, they fit snug. I went down there like I do most things at that time of my life without a worry in the world, and I just get this and bring it home and put it on. It doesn't go in the car. And I don't remember how I did it, but I think I put it in the glove compartment. I mean, I don't know how I got it home, but I was just like, you know, you just stand in there. But I had this car, and the car of many colors, and I did not know this, but they don't hold a lot of oil. Like an American car, 4 or 5 quarts of oil. I think a Volkswagen at that time, they're air-cooled. They were fairly simple. They had like, I don't know, a pint of oil. And there are 2 lights on the dashboard. The one on the left, I don't have any idea what that was. Okay, it never came on. It might have been the high beam. Maybe I think it was the high beam thing. Your high beams are on, okay? This is a car that filled the windshield wiper fluid to washer was filled by the spare tire, and it had a hose that attached to it and then went to the bottle that held the water. That's how you kept water to flush your window, okay? Now, I'm not a genius, but I was like, isn't that taking air from the spare tire if you needed that spare tire? So I'm going to Trevecca, and I'm driving highway speeds. Let's just say I was concentrating, okay? So there wasn't any room between the floorboard and the pedal. I mean, I'm going. And the right light came on. Do you know what the right light is? The right light is an indication that your engine is seizing because there's no oil in the engine. Now, I didn't know that then, okay? I didn't know that. But I later learned from the guy that's kicking the tire going, what kind of idiot drives a car like this and doesn't put oil in it? Well, I didn't know you had to put oil in the car. You put gas in it. That's how you work that whole thing, okay? You put gas in it, and occasionally you got to put water in that little tank in the front to put clean your windshield. So I learned that that light on the right, if it ever goes red, it's a warning. Pull over and stop now. Okay? I will tell you that when that light came on and stayed on, and the engine went, that's exactly what it sounded like. You know, you had that VW sound. You know the VW sound I'm talking about, and at 75 miles an hour. It just went quiet. The windows were down. There's no air conditioning. It just went quiet. I slammed my foot on the clutch, got it out of gear. I coasted for 5 miles. That's how far I coasted at those highway speeds. And I had just come over the hills into this flat valley. And I was still going highway speeds for 3.5 miles. I just want you to know. Those tires rolled and I went. And I got out of this car and I'm looking at this car and I start walking to the exit that's like 2 miles down the road. And this car drives by and the lady, you can tell it's a husband and a wife, the lady looks at me and I gave her the look and she turned her husband. I watched all this happen as they, you know, went by me. She turns to the husband and the husband pulls over. You know, it was one of those things where, you know, she knew I was in trouble. It's a whole mother thing. And I got in the car and they drove me and I got to get a tow truck and got to tow that all the way to Trevecca. I cannot tell you how much fun that was. But that little red light, that warning light that I hadn't paid any attention to, destroyed my car. Sometimes you really have to pay attention to the warning lights in your life. And I'm telling you that in these days, that light's flickering. There's stuff going on. God wants us to acknowledge that we're on a different path. God wants us to be the witness. God wants us to be encouraged by His Word. God wants us to be prayer warriors for ourselves, for our loved ones, and for our five, for the people around us. Matthew 7:13-14. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. We are in a spiritual battle. We have tools the world cannot defeat. Let's be actively at it. Let's recognize that we are the front line warriors. Let's speak for the living God who has called us to be His children, to be His people, to be His witnesses. And as we move towards our time of prayer, maybe there's some weakness in your plan that God has flashed that warning light. Listen to Him before He grows silent. Allow Him to correct and discipline. Allow Him to encourage and to move you on. Allow Him to point out how you are His child and you are His witness. Regardless of your circumstances, God knows where you're at and wants to use that for His glory. So as we move towards our time of prayer, you're invited to pray here, at home, where you're at this morning. And may the Lord's Holy Spirit come to us now.
Peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. my life laid down. I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father, we bow our hearts before you this morning. We hear the words of warning. We evaluate our lives, and we pray, Lord God, that where we have shallowed the angle, that you would speak to us and help us get back in the right direction. For Father, where we're weak, that you would make us strong. Father, where we don't realize our worthiness in your eyes, that you would make us well aware of that today. We thank you for your faithfulness to us and the goodness that you have brought to our lives, to our congregation. Father, we celebrate today how you have watched over the sick in our church. You brought some back today. Others will be here next Sunday because of your goodness. Ruth is getting better, and we pray, Lord God, you continue to watch over her and continue to bring her along. We pray today for your servant Don Shanklin and Linda, and we ask, Lord God, that you would be with them and would care for them. We have great concern for Don and for the trouble he's facing, and we pray that you'd go to them and would bring them comfort and peace and healing. Father, there are others in our midst who need to hear from you today, not only about physical ailments, but simply about the hurt they have, the anger they're facing, the sorrow that is trying to engulf them. And we pray, Lord God, that you would just come to these people and would speak to them. Bring them words of love, acts of kindness. Place your healing balm around their heart and around their minds, we pray. Father, some are looking for your wisdom to know what to do in their situations. Others want to know your will so that they can follow it. We pray, Lord God, that you'd be very active in our midst. We thank you for your presence and how you have been with us, how you're with us this morning. Father, we want to be your people. We want to stand in opposition to the world. We want to stick out so that people will know where they can come and find help in their time of need. Forgiveness and mercy can be offered to them by our words and leading them to your Son. We pray, Lord God, that you would watch over us. You would watch over this campus, these buildings. Father, that you would preserve them and keep them safe from the evil one. We pray, Lord God, that you would be with our leaders. You'd be with our president. Father, that he would hear your voice. He would respond to your call of obedience. That he would respond to an infilling of your Holy Spirit. That he would be your man in that position. Father, we pray that you'd help us with the evils of our society. Help us to fight them and to stand against them. We pray, Lord God, that you would help us figure out how we might just drive away the evils of abortion. Father, the taking of human life, and we pray that you would just allow us some channel that we might focus on. Father, that we would have opportunities to clothe those that are cold and feed those that are hungry. That you would help us to be in the lives of people who just need a Christian influence. Would you be with those in prison? And would you care for them and speak to their hearts and to their needs? We thank you, Lord God, for your well care of us. And we give you glory and praise. We honor you today for who you are. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I want to remind you of our contact information that's available. We can be reached at those numbers. The offering plate's in the back, and I thank you for those that use that, those that mail it in. You're faithful in that, those of you that use PayPal. In all these ways, God's church here on this spot is being financed and taken care of because of the faithfulness of God's stewards. And we thank God and we thank you for doing that. Don't let up. Keep it going. We notice your help. Let me remind you that this Wednesday night at 5:30, we'll be praying in the sanctuary. And then at 6 o'clock, we'll be studying the book of Ephesians. Then on the last Saturday of the month, which I guess is this coming Saturday, the 30th, there will be a baby shower in the fireside room at 1 o'clock. I'm thinking it's 11 o'clock, so there'll probably be food. And we are having a baby shower for a young lady who really doesn't have any family in the area, needs some Christian friends, and she needs the influence of some Christian ladies in her life. You can see, Jeannie, raise your hand, please. You can see Jeannie, and she'll give you some ideas about how we might just help her, okay? I'm so glad you're here this week. Just pray that you have a great Sunday where you enjoy the presence of the Lord, that He's close, that you stay safe, that you stay strong, that you trust in the divine physician, that you are one of those He can count on to speak for Him. Let's read the Apostles' Creed together. Here's what we believe. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church of Jesus Christ, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And to those that are watching online and you just read that out loud and you looked around to see if anybody was listening, we were listening. And we appreciate your participation in the Apostles' Creed. It is good to see you. And I'm glad that you've been here, glad that you've been watching online. I get the great opportunity now to pray for you before we go. Receive this benediction. Father, I ask now that you'd fall upon those watching, those that are listening, those that are here, that you'd fall upon them with your love, with an overwhelming sense of your presence in their life, that they would realize this week that you matter to them and that we really matter to the world. Would you help us by our actions, through covered faces, to convey the gospel? Care for us and be with us, we ask, Lord Jesus. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. God bless you, and you're dismissed this morning. Hey, you'll be gone.